word says clearly, nothing is impossible for God. We thank you, Father. We surrender this day to you, God. A day of worship, praise. We dedicate it to you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
I thank you. You may be seated, folks.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning.
Good morning.
Amen. We are going to receive the Lord's tithes and offerings. Amen. Amen. And we want to give God glory with everything that we received, and we want to give back, continually doing God's work. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we come before you. Merciful and great you are. We want to praise you and give you glory this morning, thanking you for all the wonderful gifts that you have given us, Lord. And Father, we ask today that you would bless the gift that we give back to you for your glory, Lord. We ask that you bless it and that you multiply it. And God, we're grateful for all that we have. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, and amen.
Praise the Lord. I do have one announcement for this morning. Next Saturday is our clothing drive giveaway. So if you know people or yourself that would like to come out, the clothing is free. And it's nice stuff. And it'll be next Saturday here in the Halbrand. And we're also planning our own City Limits Flea Market next week, which will be in the parking lot. So there'll be like two things happening at the same time. So it'll be exciting. And Sunday we're having a fundraiser luncheon too. So please join us for that.
God bless you. Amen. Maybe to be announced later. Amen. Well, happy 4th of July weekend. Amen. Amen. Thankful for our freedom. Amen. Yeah. Mr. Ruthie, who's a citizen just a few years, right? We don't want to forget the freedom, the greatest freedom we have that Jesus gave us, freedom of life and eternal life. Amen. I just want to say thank you to the Timothy House. I was over at the office right before service, and I have never seen it look that nice and clean. So thank you to all of us.
Say a special thank you to all the guys who were kind of a Gene Kelly singing in the rain last week. Maybe the rest of you don't know, but we left here after spending the week here, and we went to Patterson to minister down there. They had bands and everything, people all lined up to speak and preach. Set up a big canopy in the park in the Bucky Bowl, a Lucas Dollar Park, it's called in Patterson, and it just rained. Blew the whole tarp off. They had all this expensive equipment, big stuff. They had to put it all away, and we just started singing out loud to the growth program, and just kind of made a little thing happen there. I don't know what we call it. I just want you to know Pastor Tom called me and just said, thank you. Making some noise. Thank you so much.
Amen.
Hey, Pastor Ben is going to preach today. Pastor Ray Cardin said that he was feeling a little sick, yeah. Are Vinny around? Did I have Vinny? Vinny, did you say something to Tyler? Did you have
Good morning. We are totally relying on the Holy Spirit this morning. You know how we say, I'm not following my notes? I have no notes. Amen?
Amen.
So, I am totally trusting. Totally trusting. But the verse that I read this morning for my devotion at home was Psalm 139.
Amen.
And someone passed away this morning. But that's what we need to focus on this morning. And we are going to have the Lord's Supper. Are we okay? Ivan, would you please?
Father in heaven, Lord, we come before you today. God, thanking you for a beautiful morning, another day, just to get closer to you and to know you more, Lord. We thank you for Pastor Bev, Lord, to bring the message, Lord. Whatever it is that you will give her, Lord, let us listen and hear exactly what you are going to present to us today by the power of your Holy Spirit, Lord. That you would touch her from the top of her head to the bottom of her feet, Lord. And God, that we would be open and receptive to what you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen,
amen,
amen, amen, and amen.
This is my favorite psalm. I hope somebody remembers that for my funeral. You're in charge of that. This was the first scripture that grabbed my heart when I was born again. And the situation was one where I had just recently given my heart to the Lord, although I was in religion my whole life. And we had friends visiting from Massachusetts. And I remember they turned on Saturday Night Live. And I normally didn't watch that, but that particular night they had a skit about Jesus, and the whole thing was making fun of him.
Wow.
And it tore my heart out. I never felt like that before. I was like so upset that they would speak this way about my Jesus that I just felt.
Amen.
And I remember going up to bed and coming down the next morning and telling Jeff, don't you ever, ever, ever allow that to happen in our house again.
Amen.
Yeah, that's who died for us. That's my Savior. And there's people laughing at him. And that night, when I went up to bed, I opened the Bible and I read Psalm 139. And it just spoke to me. It's supposed to be like the blueprint of us, of our life, of humanity. So it just calmed me. It made me know who I was in God. And I just encourage each and every one of you that if you don't know this psalm personally, that to seek it out. You know, when you're feeling lonely, when you're feeling far from God, to seek it out, and you will find him. He will meet you. He will meet you. Amen.
Amen.
So we're going to go through it verse by verse. You need to be done by 10:30. I'm just letting the Holy Spirit know how much time we have. Amen. We read in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. This psalm was written by King David. O Lord, you have searched me and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. Now we have to remember that David, as a young boy, as a shepherd, he knew God in an intimate way out in the fields. And he had talked about how God gave him the power to overcome lions and all kinds of beasts. So he knew God, but he also knew that God knew him.
Amen.
And when he sinned with Bathsheba, he saw that beautiful woman on the roof. He should have been off fighting battles,
was tempted and gave in to that temptation, he knew that God, he couldn't hide from God.
Amen.
Amen. Right. But we sometimes fool ourselves, right? We think, well, nobody's watching. You know, what does Pastor say? Character is who we are in the dark when no one is there.
Amen.
So he knew God was there all the time. Verse 3, you discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you know it completely, O Lord. Can you imagine that you think that your thoughts inside your head are private, and maybe your thoughts are different from your actions? You know, maybe when you walk into church, you think, oh, I need to act a certain, oh, I'm in church now. You know, you walk straighter, you kneel more, you sing more. But God knows, you know, was that thought on your tongue before you even walked in the door today? He knows. Verse 5, you hem me in behind and before. You have laid your hand upon me. So there's no place that we can go. If we go forwards, if we try to go back to our past, to the right or the left, there's nowhere that we can step. The Lord has us hedged in, and it's a beautiful place to be.
Amen.
If you have faith and if you've surrendered to God, that's exactly where you want to be. You want that hedge of protection around you, right? Amen?
Amen.
Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. When you think of, I often think about this when I'm up in a plane, and you look down at the whole world, the earth. Or we were at NASA this past year and saw a lot of the videos that were taken, you know, from the spacecraft as they go around the world, and you can really see from space how small the world is. So when you think about, you know, the world is like this, and all the people in all the countries, all over the globe, and that God knows you, that he knows your thoughts, he knows when you sit and when you stand. That is too much for me to handle. I don't know about you. And people say, well, how can there be a God? You know, how can that be? How can he know my thoughts? You know, and more as technology is increasing, you know, think about it. Think about the technology that allows you to speak to someone across the world, to know what they're thinking at the very moment, right? And that's just a small smidgen of what God can do, because he created all of this up here that's created that technology, right? There was an app. We were over at our son's two nights ago, just sitting on the deck, and we were watching fireworks from three different locations. We weren't sure which was Dorney's, which was J. Bernie Crumb's, which was up our way, but we could see them all. And then our two granddaughters started looking up at the stars, and there's an app for that, and you can hold it up, and it'll show you which star it is. They're like, look, Nana, there's the Little Dipper. Oh, here's the Big Dipper. I'm like, oh my gosh, I don't even know these, you know. And you're a six-year-old is telling me via an app, you know. But God knows even more than that.
Amen.
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 Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Listen to this. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. Did you ever try and run away from God? I say try. Try. We cannot be successful because he is everywhere. matter where we go, there is no place to hide, nowhere to run, nowhere to hide. He is there. And we might fool ourselves, you know, that that he's not there. We might, you know, close our eyes and, well, I can't see anything, so he must not be there. He is there. He is there.
Amen.
Amen. Be hopeful. It says, if I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me, and your right hand will hold me fast. Did you ever look out at the ocean? That's one of the places where it's so obvious how small I am and how big God must be to create that massive body of water, and that's just one of them, you know. And then, so if you go to the farthermost ends of the sea, he is still there. And his hand, you know, did you ever, when you're worshiping, I like to just sometimes, we're praying about being in God's hand. He's that close. He's that close. Amen. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. Remember, God created everything. He created the light. He created the earth. And there is no darkness where God is. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. This is, imagine, they didn't have ultrasound when David was writing this. They didn't know that, yes, there is a baby in the womb. That baby is so beautifully made, so knit together and perfect. That God was even there. You know, we might think, well, when is a child? You know, is it after it's born, some people would say. But David says, and we know that God inspired it, that is a baby. Amen. In the womb, knit together. Amen. Knit together. That God was there the day that my mother gave birth, that I can't even remember, but if she were still alive, she would tell me about it, I'm sure. Amen. For you created my inmost being, you knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. You know, if someone asks, how do you know that there's a God? You know, without even referring to the Bible, you know, just look at how our bodies work. The fact that we can see, that we can hear, that we can smell and taste and touch. It's amazing how we interact, how we feel a breeze. How do you communicate how you feel a breeze on a day like today? Or how you feel the sun beating down on you. We are wonderfully and fearfully made. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. Your eyes saw my unformed body. How many? I think it's 56 million abortions since 1973 when Roe versus Wade was passed. 53 million babies have been aborted. And imagine, God saw each and every one of those. And each and every one of those babies is living right now.
Amen.
Amen. No baptism required. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. You know, some people fear, like, well, when am I going to die? You know, Jack and I talk about this sometime, and as you get older as a couple, you wonder, well, who's going to die first, you know? And I want to be selfish. And they're going to say, let me go first, God. But then, you know, then I think maybe, I don't know who could handle it better, neither, really. But it's already written in his book. You know, we each have an expiration date, just like that milk carton, you know, that's already been written in the book. So unless we do something to interfere with that, that is the date. So it doesn't matter. We don't need to be fearful. We don't need to be afraid. We just need to be confident that we know God and that, you know, I say, well, go ahead, scare me, kill me, go ahead. I'm just going to be seeing my Jesus in like 5 seconds. So come on. I didn't mean it, Irene. Oh, that's... Don't scare me like that. Sometimes they listen too well. All right. So all the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. If I were to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. Think about how many grains of sand you think there are on all beaches in all the world. And God thinks of you more than that. Every second of every day. When I awake, I am still with you. And that's a sweet thing if you can get in the habit of having God be the first thing in your mind when you wake up in the morning. Amen. Here's the four verses that spoke to me that night, that Saturday night, last night, that I was so angry. And it says, if only you would slay the wicked, O God, away from me, you bloodthirsty men. They speak of you with evil intent. Your adversaries misuse your name. Do I not hate those that hate you, O Lord, and abhor those who rise up against you? I have nothing but hatred for them. I count them as my enemies. Part of us wants to go into that battle mode, you know, that's where David went. You know, these are my enemies, I'm going to fight them, and everyone who is against you, God, you know, I'm gonna go to battle. You know, but we have to think about the world that we live in today and what a battle it is every day. Every day there's enemies of God out there, the Satan is influencing this world in every way, in every medium that he can think of to distract us from this God, to let us know, oh, God doesn't really care about you. You know, you're just a little smidgen of sand. You know, God doesn't think of you. He doesn't care about you. He doesn't care if you live or you die. And you might as well just have fun and go out now, you know, drink. Use drugs, do whatever you're going to do because you're only young once, right? So you might as well just go get it all out of your system, you know? But I don't think God really wants us to look at people as enemies because look at his example. You know, did he look at the woman who was caught in adultery when they dragged that woman? Where was the man? That's what I want to know. They dragged the woman. It was a sin for both. But they dragged her, and there she sat. And all the accusers were there, ready to stone her. They had picked up the stones. And what did Jesus do? He didn't say, oh, she's an enemy. She's an enemy. Give me a stone. You know, let me stone her. But he just said, what? Whoever is without sin, you throw the first stone. So this mentality of, you know, and at the night, that night, I looked at these people on Saturday Night Live, and they were my enemies, and they were nowhere that you can go to escape from him, that he is before you and behind you and aside of you and at the opposite end of the sea, and his thoughts of you are more than all the grains of sand. Finally, David says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart." My heart. Remember, that's the place of our intentions, our motives. Even as Christians, we are all going to come before Jesus Christ and be judged. And it's not going to be, oh, you're going to heaven or you're going to hell. We're going to go to heaven. But he's going to want to know, you know, Bev, why did you get up and preach? You know, were you seeking fame and fortune? You know, were you seeking attention, recognition? You know, or were you seeking to really get people to know me? That they would know my heart. So it's very important. It's very serious. We can't get complacent and think, well, I'm just fine. I'm coming to church. I'm doing my devotions, you know, even on my own. You know, but God wants to know everything that you do. Are you doing it because somebody's watching you? And somebody's saying, wow, Sister Ruthie, that's great. You know, you're going to teach class this morning. And, you know, even though, you know, whatever. But why are you doing that? You know, why do we have a heart for the youth? You know, why do you hole up in the back in the kitchen making hot dogs for 2 nights? You know? It's not because I'm going to mention it today. Sure. Half the people don't even know they were in the back of the context. But God knows.
Right.
See, God knows. And he knows their hearts.
Amen.
Why were they doing it? You know, we can never repay God. We can never make it up to God. We can never make our way into heaven. There's no works that we can do that is greater than the work Jesus did for us on the cross.
Amen.
So it's only through Jesus Christ that we have salvation, and not through ourselves. But our hearts have to be right. So we have to ask God, and God will show you. You know, if you say, "Search me, O God, know my heart. Test me." Oh, that's a hard one. I'll tell you right now. If you pray this prayer, "Test me, O God," test will come your way.
Amen.
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 And there's a difference between temptation and test.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Temptations come from Satan. He wants to tempt you to sin against God. But tests come from God. And he wants to test you to see your heart.
Amen.
Okay. You know, Bev, I know you'll serve me, you know, if everything is good, you have a good marriage, but, you know, how about if your son is on the wrong path, you know, going down the wrong path and, you know, using drugs or in jail or whatever, then will you get mad at me? You know, and I've never understood how people could get mad at God. Like, their life is perfect, and then someone in their family will get cancer, and they're mad at God. How could God let this happen? You know, and that's where I say, you know, Jesus didn't die to make our life easy. He died to make it eternal.
Amen.
Eternal. If God let his only begotten son come down to earth and be beaten and have a crown of thorns put on his head and have nails put into his hands and his feet and a sword at his side, who am I to say, you know, what should happen to my child? That's his decision. That's his decision. But not mine. But I can't get mad at God for it. If God didn't make the decision, he gave us free will and choice, right? So pray that prayer. Say, God, you know, search my heart. Test me. Test me. Bring things in. And we shouldn't be surprised when there are tests. When just when you think, okay, I'm coming back to you, Lord, you know, I'm born again, and I'm recommitting my life to you, and now everything's going to be just fine, you know, Satan doesn't want you to be close to God. He does not want God, you know, are not equal. You know, people Amen. Talk about like the good, the little devil on my shoulder and the little angel, and one's whispering in this ear and one's whispering in this ear, and of course I'm deaf in one ear, so I'm hoping the good angel's on the good ear side. But you know, people make it sound like it's a competition between God and the devil. But God created Satan. He's a fallen angel. And God is greater than any test,
yes.
than anything that the devil can bring before you. Amen?
Amen.
So, search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me, and know my anxious thoughts. God knows when we have things ringing in our pocket. God knows everything that you're worried about. Remember, he knows your thoughts before you even think them.
Amen.
So nothing makes God anxious. Nothing made Jesus nervous. Not once in the Bible did he say, hurry up, we have to go, Lazarus is sick. You know, let's get the fastest horse and let's get there right away. He was never anxious about anything because he had that power and that peace in his heart. And when they came and told them that Lazarus, his friend that he loved so much, was dead, his response was, let's wait 3 days. What kind of friend says that? What kind of friend says, I don't think we should go just yet. Let's just hold up. Don't go yet. Let's wait 3 days. You know, and knowing the end of the story, we know that Jesus got there and he called Lazarus out from the tomb, and they said, Lord, he's been in there 3 days. Surely there must be an odor, right? And Jesus was counting on that. He was counting. He wanted Lazarus to be as dead could be. Because wow. that's the greater miracle.
Amen.
Remember, so many times in the last month, things I've been preaching, like Jairus and his daughter. Remember Jairus, he was a nobleman, and his daughter was dying at his house, and he came to Jesus, and that woman with the issue of blood interrupted and stood in front. She had the issue for 12 years, but she chose that time to cut in front of Jairus and say, Lord, you know, I'm going to get healed by touching the hem of your garment. But it was more powerful because of that interruption. Nothing is by chance. Everything, if you just look at Jesus' life, nothing is in the order that we think it should be in. So when we say test, when you say, test me, God, it might not be at all what you're thinking.
Right.
You know, it could be some tragedy. It could be something negative. It could be something great. More people have trouble handling good things in their lives. Amen. I'll say that again. More people have trouble handling good things in their lives.
Amen.
You know, get a job, get a lot of money in your hands. Wow, I can pay bills? That's where the temptation comes in. That's the temptation, you know. That's from the devil. That's not from God. But God will test you so that you read Psalms like this and you say, God, just let the Holy Spirit show me. Show me who I really am. Because I've been living my life for other people. I've been doing what people expect me to do. I've been doing what this one or that one thought I should grow up to be, whatever. And God, what do you want me to be? You know, and maybe it's not fill in the blank profession. Maybe he just wants you to love him with all of your heart and all of your soul and your strength and your mind.
Amen.
So that you can serve him wherever you are, right here this morning.
Yes.
Out on the street later this afternoon. Amen?
Amen.
Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any talked about that a lot. But what died in the garden was that relationship, right? Mm-hmm. So that was broken. And then you're born again, and you get reconnected to God. So that's, we say, positional. It was, you know, you can mention a date and time when you surrender to the Lord. But then it's also progressive. Okay, is there any offensive way in me? And what I love about God is that you pray that prayer, he's not going to show you everything that's offensive to him the same day, at the same time. He's not going to, you know, download the list. Your printer's going to be printing and printing and printing and printing.
Amen.
You know? No. He shows you every day something else. That we're never there, we're never finished, we're never at the end of the list, but we don't know the whole list.
Right.
We just know today, Lord, what's offensive to you.
Amen.
Today, Lord.
Amen. That's right.
And, you know, some things are more obvious than others. When I was first born again, I mean, we used to go to R-rated movies. It was just what people did, right? But you get that heart that's the heart of God, and you try to go to a movie like that, or something comes on TV. You know, we've been talking about, there's some great shows, great actors, great plots, and you get kind of hooked in the first, you know, one or two shows. And then the third show, bam, you know, there they are, doing all the sins that Jesus died on the cross for, you know, and we're looking at them as entertainment. You know, so God showed me that. He made my heart grieve and think, oh my gosh, what am I watching here, you know? Or, you know, what am I drinking, you know? And not that having one drink you're going to go to hell, but why would I want to interrupt the peace that I have in my heart and my mind?
Amen.
With anything? And if you do want to interrupt that, then you don't have the peace of God. And that's your proof that there's a God. Because if you believe in him, you will have that peace.
Amen.
And you will get to the end of your road of searching for things other than God. So, search me, O God, and know my heart. What we're going to do, I'm going to open the altars. We're going to have communion in a few minutes.
Amen.
So, very important that we take that seriously. You might say to yourself, I'm not right. I can't take communion today. But Jesus didn't give that option at the Last Supper.
Right.
Judas was at the Last Supper. He didn't say Judas took this one out. Okay, so you need to make your heart right. And we're going to do that by praying these last two verses. And then we invite you up to the altar. Let's all make our hearts right. And then we'll share the word. So, amen?
Amen.
Okay, I just pray, Lord, that you just give us your eyes and your heart today, Lord God, that as we pray this, Lord, that it would be new. Even if we prayed it many, many times, Lord God, it would be new today. New today. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Intimately know me, Lord. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Amen. So maybe you've never really believed that God was that real, that he was there every morning when you woke up. Maybe you don't feel his presence that strongly in your life. I just invite you to come up to the altar and just pray, invite him in, and maybe you've never asked God to test you. Maybe you've just been going along on your own and just measuring yourself against the world. But today, God wants you to measure yourself against Him and His heart. Maybe you just need to come forward and just tell God, you know what, I'm sorry. When David sinned, he said, Lord, I have sinned against you, Lord, first. That before we sin against our families or our church family, that the very first person we sin against is God. And He is so huge. He is so wonderful. He's so magnificent. And He loves you so much. He knit you together in your mother's womb. Before you were even born, He knew you. Father God, we just take a couple of minutes here, Lord, and we ask you to test us, Lord. Show us just for this day. Thank you for having mercy that you don't overwhelm us, but for today, Lord God, what do we need to do today, Lord?
cup and drink it. And any time that you drink this cup, keep me in remembrance for my broken body and my shed blood that was for you. And he added a promise. He said, till I come again and sup with you. We thank you, Father, for your broken body and your shed blood. And we thank you for that blessed hope that you will come again to take those that you have redeemed. We pray these things in Jesus' name. And now we take the cup and the bread. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this wonderful day. We thank you that we are fearfully made. We thank you that your thoughts are so great of us, greater than the grains of the sand, Lord God. So I just pray your blessing on each and every one.